Hello, David Diga Hernandez here, and welcome to Spirit Church. Today I'm going to be talking to you about becoming a soul winner. I'm going to give you four things that have to happen before your heart can be set ablaze for souls. And I really do believe that God wants to put the spirit of evangelism in his people for such a time as this. Stephen Moctezuma is with me as usual. He's going to be leading you in the song, Created Me a Clean Heart. Go ahead and worship with Stephen. Come back and hear this lesson.
Created me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Created me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Oh, we just sing that again. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Oh, create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. We sing, cast me and cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. And renew a right spirit within me. We sing, cast me and cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. And renew a right spirit within me. And renew a right spirit within me. Yes. And renew a right spirit within me.
Come on, we sing and renew.
And renew a right spirit within me. Renew a right spirit within me.
Well, I prayed that you enjoyed that worship, and I really do believe that as you ask the Lord to create in you a clean heart, that he's doing just that. We serve a merciful God, and we should be thankful for that, knowing that according to 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us. So it's always good to come before the Lord and be open and honest. I love the way that King David put it when he said, search me, O God, and remove anything that is something that you don't like. And I really do appreciate that heart, and I pray that you adapt it to that heart as you sang that song. So speaking of your heart, I'm going to be talking to you about having a heart for the lost, or a burden for the lost, or someone who is a soul winner. Now, I'm aware that when this topic is covered in various circles, that often it's covered in a way that is meant to inspire guilt into the listener. So in other words, you know, if you're not approaching every single person that you ever talk to in the grocery store, at the gas station, that you're just not a real Christian. And I really don't believe that that's necessarily what God has called us to. Now, there are times where the Holy Spirit will work on your heart or draw you to witness to certain individuals. And that's a part of the everyday Christian life. I really do believe that evangelism is a lifestyle. But more importantly, I do believe that evangelism, one of the most effective forms of evangelism, is relational evangelism. And this is evangelism that has to do with our friendships, our family, and those types of connections that are familiar with us from the day-to-day basis. So you at your work, you win the lost. You in your family, you win the lost. And wherever you go at school, you win the lost. So kind of on your regular route, you're winning the lost. Now, this doesn't mean that I don't believe in evangelizing strangers or things like that, although I don't necessarily want to guilt anybody into doing those things. I do want you to be spirit-led in everything that you do. I will say that it's important that we hear the Holy Spirit on the daily basis, that he will guide us to evangelize as he's led us to do. But when I talk about this, I think that the issue is not necessarily trying to do behavior modification. In other words, a lot of messages that have to do with evangelism or acquiring a heart for the lost focus on telling you what to do, you know, 3 or 4 souls a day. If you don't win 3 or 4 souls a day, then you're not doing your job. And I think that that goal-oriented evangelism, though it's good in its outlook, though it's good in the intention that's behind it, I don't think it necessarily produces the fruit that the scripture tells us we should see. Rather, I think that we should develop a heart that is so in love with Jesus that we want him to receive the reward of his suffering. In other words, everything that he died to receive on the cross, we should be passionate about making sure he receives that. And so when it comes to evangelism, I think that if we can develop a heart for the lost, that is the cure to the lack of evangelism that we may see here in the modern age, especially in the American church. I think that church invitation is not necessarily evangelism, or sin confrontation is not necessarily evangelism, though that's part of evangelism. We do need to preach the gospel full and uncompromised. You know, to preach heaven without hell, grace without repentance, forgiveness without repentance, that's borderline heresy. So I do believe in preaching the gospel and preaching against sin as Jesus told his disciples to do. But again, what I want to get at today here is the heart of the issue. So rather than assign you with goals, rather than assign you with phrases that may inspire guilt, and there are some things in this message that certainly will inspire conviction because they're of the Word of God, they're truth. And many times when we hear truth from the Word of God, we receive such conviction. But again, my goal is to talk to you about the heart of evangelism, the heart that is burdened for souls. If you can acquire this heart, evangelism will flow from you naturally as a lifestyle, and it won't be something you feel you have to check off your list or you feel guilty, or that every person you ever don't preach the gospel to, their blood is on your hands. That's not what I believe, and that's not certainly what the Bible doesn't teach that. So first of all, here are 4 things that we can do that I believe will inspire the heart for the souls, the heart for the lost. So first one is, number one, we need to hear their cry. And we find the inspiration for this first point in Exodus chapter 3. And this is where Moses finds his calling, so to speak, from God to go and deliver the people of Israel. So this is what Exodus chapter 3 says, beginning in verse number 1. One day, Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness and came to Sinai, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't that bush burning up? I must go see it." When the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, God called to him from the middle of the bush, "Moses, Moses." "Here I am," Moses replied. "Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of the harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. It is a land flowing with milk and honey, the land where the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites now live." Now, we know, or most of us know, the rest of the story. We're quite familiar with this text. This is where Moses receives the call of God. This is where God comes down and sort of disrupts everything that is going on in Moses' life. Now, we know Moses fled from Egypt. That was where he was originally from. And Egypt, in the scripture to us, is a picture of sin. The children of Israel is a picture of the modern day man. And Egypt is a picture of the modern day sin of that man. So sin is slavery. In fact, the scripture says that those who are living in sin are slaves to that sin. Now, I've talked to people and they say, well, I'm just perfectly happy doing what I'm doing and I'm living my life and I'm enjoying it. And they say, I'm not in any bondage. I'm free to do as I wish. And so one of the things I often challenge the people who are living in sin to do, I tell them this. I say, okay, if you really don't believe that sin is a bondage, just try to stop. Just try to leave that lifestyle for a week, for a month. Do it for 3 days. And once they actually try to escape that lifestyle, they find out, in fact, that they are living in a bondage. It's the same as an alcoholic who won't admit that he is an alcoholic because he's afraid of what he'll have to confront to overcome such an addiction. So sin is a prison. Sin is not being free to do as you wish. Sin is to live in depravity, in darkness, is to be chained to do what is the baser of your nature. Sin is bondage. Sin is darkness. Sin is sickness. And so Moses is confronted by God, and God says this. He says, I've come down. Now think about this. God says, I've come down to set the people free. I've come down, and who did he go to? God said, I've come down, and then he goes to Moses. You see, whenever God is going to act in the earth, because he has given dominion to man, God has to move through a vessel if he is going to move in the earth. Now, I'm not saying that it is impossible for God to do anything on the earth without the permission of man and without the participation of man, but I am saying that God, for the most part, though there are some exceptions, will choose to use a vessel, a human vessel, to respond to the needs of mankind. Often the atheist will look up and ask, well, if God exists, why is there so much evil in the world? Well, one could easily reverse it on the atheist and ask the question, if God doesn't exist, why is there so much good? The point is that God leaves man the responsibility of caring for this world because he gave us dominion since the beginning. That's how it's worked. So God has sent men to do the things that need to be done. God has sent men to accomplish goodness in the earth. The problem is not that God doesn't respond, it's that men don't obey. And so here, God comes down, he says, I'm coming down, and then he comes to Moses, he says, but I'm choosing you. So he said, I've seen the oppression of my people. So God has watched and he's seen the Israelites living in the oppression, the slavery of Egypt, which is a picture of us to sin. And he says, I'm gonna send someone, and we know that Moses was a likeness of Christ. But in another sense, Moses is a likeness of those whom God has called. And so God tells Moses, look, I've come down, I've seen the oppression, and I've heard their cries. Now, Moses would have never heard the cries of the Israelites had God not taken a moment with him. You see, if we're going to hear the cry, we have to get into the deep places of prayer where we can hear the voice of God. We think, or many think, I should say, that when they begin to pray, that it's going to be all blessings and just a clear path all the way to where God has called me. No, the call of God is an adventure. It's a journey. And there are challenges that come our way. And that's part of what makes the life of the believer the most exciting life that you could possibly live here on the earth today. But the issue is not necessarily that the cries aren't there. It's that we're not hearing the cry. Even Christians can become so comfortable in what God has blessed them in that we fail to hear the cries of the lost. But can't you hear it? I mean, when I think of all that's going on in the world, it's very obvious that the world is crying. Think of all of the damage that false religion, and false religion included in that category, are the so-called Christians who carry out acts of violence and hate throughout the world. False religion is tearing men apart, giving God a bad name. Think of all the shootings that have become so commonplace now that we're almost numb to the idea of mass shootings. Now, obviously, we know that when these shootings happen, this isn't because of a financial issue. This isn't a political issue. It's not a moral issue. It's a spiritual issue. I mean, some people cry out, take the guns. Other people cry out, put in regulation. But you could do all that, and evil will always find a way to accomplish its will. Doesn't matter. The issue is the spirit. They say, well, you know, we need to do more of this or more of that, and that's fine if man wants to do it. But let me tell you something. So long as sin abounds, tragedy is going to abound. You think of everything going on in the world, all the starvation, all of the tragedy, all of the calamity, all of the darkness. The world is crying. Every time I see across my television screen a news alert or something happening in our world that's tragic, my heart breaks. I mean, I'll tell you, one of the ones that affected me more than probably any other shooting was the Sandy Hook shooting. I mean, I'm telling you, I mean, for 3 days after that, and I'm not, and again, this isn't to say that I felt the exact burden that what the victims felt, because nobody could know what they're possibly going through. I mean, we watch these things, we ache for a few minutes, and then we go on our way. I remember it was 3 days after I heard about that I couldn't write, I couldn't read, I couldn't focus, I had trouble eating, because I was just thinking about how horrible it must have been for those poor children. And everything in me just was broken for them. I mean, I even wanted to write something in response to it, but I was so emotional, I said, Lord, I can't even write anything right now. And I mean, just imagine what it's like to be in the families that experienced that tragedy firsthand. I mean, this should be enough to tell us that the world needs Jesus. And every time I look at one of these tragedies, every time I see financial collapse, political calamity, you know, we're talking about weather tragedy, where typhoons, hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes and such, everything in me just says, the world needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. And I hope that as you look at this world and you look at these tragedies that are happening, number one, you have to hear the cry. Experts and pundits will analyze and assess, and they'll say, we need this, we need that, or we need to implement this law, we need to implement that idea, or we need to put these regulations down, or we need to put this program in place. That's fine. But no political program will ever replace the power of the Holy Spirit. No self-help system, no self-help system can ever be as effective as the life-changing, transformative power that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Moses, he goes and he finally comes to realize that there is a people that is crying. I mean, he had come from that place. He had come from Egypt. And he had been away from Egypt for so long that he had forgotten. He had forgotten the cries. He had forgotten the oppression. Let me ask you something. Can you hear the cry? Can you hear the cries of this dying world who needs Jesus? And if so, what are you doing to respond? Number one, we need to hear the cries. Number two, to acquire this heart for the lost, to become a soul winner, we need to, number two, share their pain. Now, I know the preachers of the new gospel that says that it's all supposed to be happiness and blessings and positive thinking. I'm all for that. We'll particularly disagree with this point. It doesn't matter. This is what the scripture says. Romans chapter 9, verse 1 through 6 says this, with Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness. Now, this is Paul the Apostle writing his letter to the Romans concerning the Jews who were not repenting. With Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness, my conscience and the Holy Spirit confirm it. My heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief for my people, my Jewish brothers and sisters. Now listen to what he says here. Now we're going to read something. Listen to what he says. This is just so powerful. And if anybody else said this beside Paul the Apostle, I might not believe them. I would think, oh, you're just being too spiritual. But listen to what he says here. This is so powerful. Second part of verse 2. I would be willing to be forever cursed, cut off from Christ, if that would save them. Think about what he's saying. He's saying, Paul the Apostle is saying, I would trade my salvation if that meant they would know Jesus. Now that's a heart for the lost. He is sharing in the pain. He is empathizing. He is caring for a people who are lost. Now obviously, Paul the Apostle understands that no sacrifice that he could ever give would equal the sacrifice that Christ gave. And he understands that the sacrifice that Christ did for us, that what Christ sacrificed is enough. It's sufficient to pay for the sins of all mankind, past, present, and future. But what he's saying is, hypothetically speaking, if it were possible, if my salvation, giving that up, meant then coming to Christ, I would do it. Do you know where people who don't accept Christ, who are cut off from Christ, go? They go to hell. I know it's not popular to preach it, but there still is a hell that is very real. And Paul the Apostle is basically saying, I'm willing to go to hell if it means that this people come to know Christ. That's beautiful. Now, to some that may be sick and twisted and demented, but let me tell you something. He wants to share in their pain. In fact, Jeremiah, I believe, the prophet, and he often is referred to as the weeping prophet, Jeremiah chapter 13, and it's somewhere in chapter 13, I believe it's verse 16, no, it's verse 17. Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 17 says, and if you still refuse to listen, I will weep alone because of your pride. My eyes will overflow with tears because the Lord's flock will be led away into exile. Jeremiah is saying that if you don't listen to the word of God, I'm not going to be angry. I'm not going to call you a sinner. I'm not going to be hateful. I'm not going to be rude. I'm not going to be mean-spirited. Jeremiah says, if you don't accept Christ, I'm going to go alone by myself, and I'm just going to weep. When is the last time you wept over souls? Do we care enough to be inconvenienced? Do we care enough to act? Sometimes we do, in this walk with Christ, have to take on burdens and sorrows. It is not all going to be blessing, joy, and positive thinking. Sometimes we have to allow our hearts to be broken, our spirits to be crushed, to be used by God. God uses the broken. God uses the shattered. God uses those who are very weak. When you hear the cry and you share in the pain, it does something in your heart. It breaks you. You know, the anointing came from olive oil, but you couldn't get that oil until the olive was crushed. The anointing comes from brokenness. Let me tell you something. Some of the most anointed men and women of God I've heard that speak to the lost, that speak as an evangelist, that speak as one who is trying to win sinners to Jesus, they are the ones who are most broken over the dying world in which we live. And it inspires me, and I pray it inspires you. And I'm not saying we need to be walking around, you know, putting ashes on our forehead, whipping our backs. I'm simply saying that somewhere in our hearts, somewhere in our Christianity, there has to be this sharing in the pain, in the sorrow, that allows the heart to break and allows the soul to be broken over the lost and dying world. Can you hear the cry? Do you share in the pain? Because it's a reality. Number one, hear their cry. Number two, share their pain. Number three, know their fate. I was talking to, and it was actually interviewing on my show. Oh man, this was several seasons ago. I think it was in the second or third season of Encounter TV. And I had this guest on, and when I brought him on, everybody just was up in arms about him. I mean, he's a very controversial figure. Now, not everyone I have on the program, I've learned that over the years that I have to say, I don't endorse everything they do, but for the most part, if I have them on the program, it means they have something I believe they can add to the body of Christ. So, like for instance, I've said this many times, some people criticize Joel Osteen. And hearing some of my messages, you may even think that I'm totally against guys. Like, not at all. I think that in Christianity, there needs to be a balance, and I believe all of us together create that balance. We need the Joel Osteens who are gifted. The Bible says if a man's gift is encouragement, let him encourage. And that's Joel Osteen, and pastors get on his case for it for no reason. I think it's jealousy, but that's a little bit of a rabbit trail. So Joel Osteen, God's gifted him as an encourager. Me, God's gifted me to bring these types of messages, and hey, that's what I'm going to do. So Joel Osteen is anointed to do one thing. And then there's this other gentleman that I had on my program. His name is Jed Smock. Very controversial. I love him, though. Very controversial. Why? Because he's extreme. You have guys on two extremes. But God has anointed both of them. God uses both of them. We need both of them. We need the Joel Osteens, and we need the hellfire preaching brimstone guys that get on the streets. We need those. Now, again, I'm not necessarily endorsing every aspect that come with those ministries, but maturity connects. Maturity looks for points of unity rather than points of division. So as Jed Smock goes, and I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying this, he's an intellectual man, so he understands where I'm coming from. But you know, with Jed Smock, some of his delivery, a little controversial. I love Jed Smock. I've had him on the program. I think he's an anointed servant of God. I've even texted him the same thing. But some people were very upset when I had him on, but I still had him on. And I was asking him about his delivery style. You know, he gets up there. Keep in mind, he's not preaching to families and things. He's on college campuses where you got the frat parties and the sleeping around and the booze and the drugs and the hippie theology and all of that. And he's the guy that goes in and he preaches. And I was thinking of King Herod. King Herod said of John the Baptist, or the Bible says of King Herod in regards to John the Baptist, that Herod was deeply troubled every time that he heard John the Baptist speak. Yet he loved to hear him speak nonetheless. And I think Jed Smock is the same way. He would go into these college campuses and he would just preach repentance. Why, against sin, which is biblical to do. And he would preach on those things. And some Christians, the immature ones, oh, brother, you got to have to be all love. And, you know, they didn't know that that was his gift, his part of the body. And so Jed Smock was telling me a story. I just want to give you a background on who he is. Very controversial. And he's giving me a background, and so he's preaching at a college campus, and he's preaching about hell. He's talking about, he's just reading scripture on hell. That's all he's doing. People are getting so upset with him. And the Christians get up, and this one Christian gets up, you know, he's real bold, he's a young guy, he's got his theology figured out, he stands up, and he goes, "Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters," and I'm paraphrasing here. He says, "What this man preaches is not the gospel. We preach love and acceptance and joy, and Jesus loves you even if you are a sinner, and you know, he shouldn't be telling you about hell, and the gospel isn't necessarily all about you repenting." He just gets up and starts doing this defense for, you know, what I call hippie Christian theology. And so he gets up there and he starts talking about how Jed Smock's way off and we love you and we, you know, on and on and on. And so finally, after this guy is done giving his little speech, this atheist stands up. And he asks, he begins to just kind of ask him some questions. So he asks the Christian who just got up and was kind of trying to sidetrack from what Jed Smock was doing. The atheist asks him, and again, I'm paraphrasing. He says, "Do you believe in hell?" And the Christian said, "Yes, of course I believe in hell, absolutely." And the atheist said, "Do you believe that if we sin, we're going to go to hell?" "Well, yes, of course, but Jesus is love, Jesus is grace, and we understand that." And the atheist said something that just was, it was amazing. He said, "So let me get this straight." He said, "This man is telling me the truth, and you're over here trying to stop him." He says, "Now, if I was you, and I believed that what someone was doing was taking them to a really horrible place, then I would be out here every day trying to warn them to not go to that horrible place." He says, "So that leads me to only two conclusions. Either you don't care that I'm going to hell, or you don't really believe it." That was coming from the atheist. And it's true. I'm not saying, as I always say, and you know I'm all for balance, I'm not saying that we need to be rude and mean-spirited, but we cannot forget that there is a heaven and a hell. There is sin and repentance. There is salvation and judgment. The Bible teaches both. And when we know their fate, when we truly believe, let me tell you something. World evangelism is a rescue mission. When you know the fate of so many souls, and you really believe this, okay, you either believe the Bible or you don't. If we really believe that people who live in sin are going to hell, we need to start preaching the gospel. Again, there's no need to be mean. There's no need to be rude. But in love and in power, we must present the gospel, the good news of salvation, that Jesus saves from sin and from hell. We need to know their fate. So number one, hear their cry. Number two, share their pain. Number three, know their fate. And I want to read this to you. It's a little excerpt, just a little something that I wrote a while ago. And it's just my description of hell. I had a horrible dream, and I'm not saying I actually went there. There's very few people, I believe, who actually had a biblical vision of hell, Bill Weiss being one of them. But I do believe that this at least inspired something in me. And if hell is anything like what I dreamt, even in principle, I needed to write this and warn people. So this is a little something I wrote. It says, hell, no amount of regret can appease it. For every moment that passes, a moment is added to the extent of one's stay. Deep frustration, hopeless turmoil, and constant confusion are forever in the soul. Hope is destroyed. After all, there is no mercy past this point. The instant your eyes catch a glimpse, your pride and stubbornness are broken, but it's too late. The moment you sense the evil, you desire the opportunity to repent. But God is not mocked. The reality is confirmed. Everything you knew in your heart to be true is now visibly apparent. You escaped the thought on earth, hoping the thought would never manifest its own reality. Every moment of sinful pleasure, every comment of mockery, every laugh at God, they turn to be regrettable, sorrowful even. To know that safety was within reach is a tormenting thought. Why such foolishness? Why such carelessness? It could have all been prevented. That is a most tormenting thought. No time exists. Hell is the constant state of highest anguish. It is darkness that will never again see light, pain that will never know comfort, and loneliness that will never again find companionship. It is the justice of God. Can you grasp the vastness of the universe? That is temporary. Hell is a universe void of all things good. Pride is the door to hell, and stubbornness is the step that takes you through. What sort of pride would walk into hellfire? What pleasure is worth the soul? Mock, laugh, scoff, and push it from your mind. It remains a reality. Life is a thin, fragile glass upon which we walk. Once it is broken, it cannot be repaired. Only fools go to hell when salvation is so near. Frustration that causes physical tension, fear that causes your heart to race, anger that brings depression, and pain that causes a scream. These are the reactions of a hellish existence. They are the eternal marks of a tormented, rejected soul. Matthew 25, 45 through 46, Mark 9, 43, 2 Thessalonians 1, 9, Ezekiel 3, 18, all tell us of the torment. In fact, Ezekiel 3, 18 says this. This is God speaking to the prophet. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way, to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, and his blood will I require at thine hand. When we don't preach the gospel, God holds us responsible for the souls that should have been saved as a result of having heard the gospel. Number one, hear their cry. Number two, share their pain. Number three, know their fate. Finally, number four, this is the hopeful end, is we gotta know their salvation. Remember when you came to Christ? Remember the joy that you felt, the lifting of the burden, the light that came breaking into the darkness that bound you. Do you remember feeling clean? Do you remember feeling the joy of being freed of past sinful mistakes? Your mind cleared of guilt and condemnation. What if you can cause that by actions of obedience to happen for someone else? When you know their salvation, I mean, yes, you hear their cry. Yes, you share their pain. Yes, you know their fate. But when you do those three things and know their salvation, what God wants to do for them, how much God loves them. Everything within you will set your heart ablaze to become an on-fire soul winner, preaching the uncompromised gospel of Jesus Christ, marching through the gates of hell, smashing the locks of the captives, and setting the slaves of sin free. This is the call that God has given to you. You have the privilege and the responsibility to carry the light of truth to a dying world. This is the joy. This is the balance. And we cannot forget the fullness that the gospel tells us of. We cannot forget the fullness of the message. But this is the most important part. See, people who preach hell and with no love cause people to become sorrowful and depressed. And if they accept their Christianity, they live it in a religious spirit and in oppression. People who preach salvation without repentance, they produce also false converts where people are walking in this hobby of Christianity, never allowing it to transform their heart, and they just march toward hell more confidently. But when you preach, as the scripture tells us to preach, repentance from sin and salvation through what Jesus has done, you join those together, the truth that is revealed to that sinner causes him to turn toward God in heartfelt, sincere repentance, and he experiences the transformative work, the miracle of salvation in his life, and it produces true conversion. We know there's salvation because we ourselves have experienced it, and we want others to experience the same. We can preach the truth in love, and that's what God has called us to do. So I'm going to read Matthew chapter 9, and this is something I observed here. I took a look at it, and I was reading this. I observed this in a book called Connectivity by Pastor Larry Neville. He's the president of Praise Chapel Christian Fellowship, the fellowship with which I'm connected. And he drew our attention to something that was very interesting in the scripture here. So Mark chapter 9, verse 35. Let me see here. This is what Jesus said, and he's talking about the need for workers. He said, and the scripture says, Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. Verse 36, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. He said to his disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest. Ask him to send more workers into the field. Now, what's amazing is immediately following that teaching of Jesus is Matthew. I'm not going to read it, but Matthew chapter 10 talks about Jesus sending out the 12 apostles. And Pastor Larry had pointed out the connection here. He said the interesting thing is that when Jesus, the very ones that Jesus told to pray for workers, themselves became the workers in the next chapter. The point is that as you pray for the lost, as you pray for God to send workers, he begins to stir you and causes you to become that worker. When you pray for God to meet a need, God develops you to become the answer for that need. Think about that. This is a powerful truth. When you pray for God to meet a need, he causes you, through those prayers, he changes your heart, he changes your character, he subjects the flesh. As you're praying those prayers for a certain need, those prayers for that need cause you to be developed into the solution to meet that very need. When you pray, it changes you into God's answer. That's powerful revelation right there. And I want you to be sure of that, that as you pray for God to meet a need in this lost and dying world, that he's going to develop in your heart the passion, the burden for the lost. And the more you pray for the lost, the more you become one who will win the lost. So prayer for the lost causes a burden for the lost. And finally, the last portion of scripture I want to read, and then we're going to have to bring this to a close, is Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. And this is a very famous scripture because we all know it. It's Romans chapter 10, verse 9. And I've read this several times, especially you, our partners, with those who get our partner letter. You know, this is kind of a theme scripture as to how I raise support, because I talked to you about the need of sending someone to go and preach the gospel. So Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says this: if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. As the scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Jew and Gentile are the same in this respect. They have the same Lord who gives generously to all who call upon him. For everyone who calls upon, or everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe him? And how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That is why the scripture says, how beautiful are the feet of messengers who bring the good news, know their salvation. So as I said at the beginning, it's good to set goals for yourself. It's good to be aware of evangelism as you go out through your daily life. But such standards, I believe personally, and I'm not going to be dogmatic about this. I'm not saying it's ungodly to do. But I think such standards like that are what create religious systemized approaches to what should otherwise be something that things that come natural out of what we've acquired by revelation of the Holy Spirit. So instead of giving you goals, instead of telling you that, you know, everyone who you pass by and don't preach the gospel to is going to hell that day, which to some degree could be true because nobody's promised tomorrow. And again, we still have to be very sensitive to the voice of the Holy Spirit. My point is that if we can develop the heart of evangelism, this will flow naturally, and it won't be something we feel forced to do. It'll be something that comes out of us naturally. It won't be like filling a quota, and if we miss, you know, if we don't lead 8 people in the sinner's prayer in one day, then we're not obeying God. And I don't want you to live under that type of oppression that comes from rule setting, so to speak. I'm not necessarily against those things, but I think this is a better way to approach evangelism, is to develop a heart for the lost, to become a soul winner in your spirit. So number one, hear their cry. Number two, share their pain, empathize. Number three, know their fate. Number four, know their salvation. Remember, praying for the lost causes you to develop a burden for the lost. I'm going to pray now that the Holy Spirit himself would set your heart on fire for lost souls. You know, ultimately, we do win souls for Jesus. People ask me, why do you do what you do? And I say, very simple, it's because Jesus wants me to. It's all for him. Yes, I care about the lost, but first and foremost, I care about Jesus. My primary goal in winning the lost is basically this. Jesus wants souls won to him. Why? Because he died on the cross to receive them. So my whole life is about getting the master what he's asked me. He wants souls, I'm going to win souls for him. He's given us this command. He sits on his throne and says, this is what I desire. Jesus desires souls. And so I say, okay, master, if that's what you want, your servant will live his whole life working to acquire that which you want. Secondly, I have a heart for the lost. I don't want to see anyone go to hell. 150,000 people, or over 150,000 people, die every day, and that's an old statistic. It might be more now. And many of those who die today are dying without Christ. We need to move, and we have to do it quickly. Number one, for Jesus. Secondly, for souls. So let's pray. Let's believe God for your healing, yes, but let's just pray. I'm going to pray that the Holy Spirit would touch you. And in this touch, you ask him. Here's the thing. You can ask Jesus, and this is going to be a special prayer because you're going to ask the Lord for whatever it is you want, and I'm going to agree with whatever that prayer is, as long as it's biblical, of course. So let's believe God, okay? So, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray for that one watching right now who's listening to this message and who so desires to be used by you as a soul winner. And so, Father, I pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would set their heart ablaze for the lost. And Lord, that thing which they are asking you, we join our faith together. We touch and agree. And we say it is done in the name of Jesus. There's a young man watching me. You're 14 years old. You've been watching these videos now for a couple days. And you know you're called by God to do something. Let me tell you something. I want to confirm that. God has indeed called you to preach the gospel. And you see, God has shown you, and you thought it was just your own thoughts, God has shown you, you preaching before thousands, praying for the sick and seeing miracles. And prophesy. Yes, God's going to give you both gifts. I'm telling you that as a confirmation today, God has called you. Well, that is it for the lesson and the ministry portion here. Here are the new members of Spirit Church. Welcome all of you. Including, we got someone from the United Kingdom here. That is awesome. And of course, from the United States. And I think, we got New Zealand on there. So I'm very excited about the different people who are joining. So welcome to Spirit Church. We love you. Now, if you're blessed by this ministry, so first, to those of you who consider yourselves Spirit Church members, your Spirit family, you can do your tithes and offering right now. Thank you for that. There are almost 100 members worldwide of Spirit Church. We love you. We're praying for you. Many will tell you that are from Spirit Church, I personally correspond with the members. I'm doing that for as long as I possibly can. Of course, once we get to the thousands, and we will get to the thousands, it's going to be impossible for me to do that. And we'll have to acquire, we'll have to put the Spirit Church correspondence into the office. But for now, I'm personally in touch with every member of Spirit Church who so desires to be in touch personally. So consider joining Spirit Church today by going to the website. And as usual, if you're someone who watches Encounter TV, remember, it's not just Spirit Church. We have three ministries going. Actually, there's 11. If you go on the ministry website, you can see those. Look under Learn About DHM, I believe. You click on Ministries, and you'll see the 11 ministries that we're now doing. You'll be very surprised to see everything that your gift is going to support. But in the meantime, maybe you're someone who watches us on television. That's Encounter TV. Is our global evangelism or worldwide television, then there's international events, and then there's global discipleship. So we're doing both global evangelism and global edification. It's a double-edged sword, this ministry. We're evangelizing the lost and edifying the believer. And if you're someone who believes that the gospel needs to be preached, you believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven, and there's no exceptions to that, and you want to see the gospel preached as it's always been intended by the Word of God to be preached, as the early church preached it, uncompromised, bold, and unashamed, with miracles, signs, and wonders, backed by the power of the Holy Spirit in love and truth, and you want to see that go all around the world, then this is the ministry. I believe you can support it, and I know God's going to bless you for it. And you look around the world, you say, Lord, I want to win souls. Lord, I want to make a difference. Lord, I want to do something. Let me tell you something. This is making a difference. And this is your chance to join in the efforts from hundreds. We have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of supporters from all over the world, almost 1,000 now, ministry supporters who on a monthly basis donate and say, we're going to stand with you, David, and we're going to give and we're going to join in. And you want to do that. You want to join that effort. When we stand together, we can do so much more. And you're saying, I want to be a part of that world evangelism. I want to make that change now. This is how you make that change. You're not powerless to make a difference. You can do it today. We need both monthly gifts, $5, $10, $20, $30 a month, and one-time gifts. Some can do $10, $20, $30 one time, $10, $20, $30 monthly. Some of you could even do $100 a month, and some of you could do a one-time gift of $500 or $1,000. I'm telling you, it helps us. All of it goes toward the preaching of the gospel. Well, that is it again for this edition of Spirit Church. Until next time, remember, nothing is impossible with God.